Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'm Nadia Jusfischteiner. I'm associate professor. I'm associate professor at the University Bourgogne-Franche-Comté. So this is located in Belfort, in the east of France. And I'm going to present a work named Architecture for an Active Fault Tolerant Control Applied to a PEM Fuel Cell System. So this work has been done in the frame of the thesis of Etienne Dijoux, who is working in co-supervision between our university and the University of the nice island of La Réunion, which is also located in France, but a little far away in the Indian Ocean. So, first, two words about our lab. So, it is the Fuel Cell Lab. It's actually a federation of several labs that put all the effort together for research about fuel cell system and hydrogen energy. So the mission is to promote fuel cell systems, hydrogen energy, by the means of research and development. And for that, we are participating to different projects, at public-funded projects, and also industrial projects. So we are today 150 researchers, among them 15 PhD students. And we are the stakeholders for the Fuel Cell Lab Federation are 8 different laboratories and organizations. And of course, as I said before, we have different public funded projects, 17 French one, national, 17 European, sorry, and 19 national. We have also several industrial projects, several of them are confidential. And today we record over 500 journal publications. The Fuel Cell Lab counts about 60% of the whole French academic publication on this domain. So we have facilities. So we share 1,200 square meters of testing area and 20 hundreds of lab offices. And we have test benches that could range from 100 watt to 30 kilowatt, so that we can cover all the applications of fuel cell. We have also mobile test benches, mainly vehicles, trucks, that goes up to 100 kilowatt. We have also the vibrating tables. So recently, up to recently, we were the only institution that has it in Europe. And this vibration table allows to test in real road application, and also climate chambers. We are also able to perform some long-term duration tests 24/7, which could allow to assess the durability of these systems. So that was just an overview of our lab. Now this is the content of my presentation. I'm going to talk about the context, of course. For those who are not familiar with fuel cell systems, so I will explain what is it and what are the issues linked to these systems. And I will try not to be very technical about the approach that the students use for this work. So, of course, the energy context is the one which is here, increase of the energy consumption. Here we can see the evolution of the world energy consumption, of course, on the period of 1990 to 2040. This is a projection up to 2012. We can see that the ratio of renewable is increasing, but also the fossil fuels. So in this context, we have also an increase of the greenhouse gases. One of the climate agreements that a lot of people talk about is the Paris. And one of the conclusions is to respond to this global climate change by keeping the global temperature right below 2 degrees C, while targeting more 1.5 degrees. So last July, our French Minister of Environment invited an ambitious 5-year plan where the commitments, more of the commitment was no longer use coal to produce electricity after 2022. Up to 4 billion euro will be invested in boosting energy efficiency, which is a record for France. And of course, and more importantly, banning all petrol and diesel vehicles by 2040. And this is a real push, and it raises a real need of non-pollutant and high-efficiency solution for transportation in France. So this is why we're more talking about hydrogen fuel system. Just a few comments on that. The debate on fossil fuels, and in particular on such a sensitive domain, which is transportation in France, is not a real anymore. And if we really apply these measures are undertaken, that will be a real catalyst for electrical vehicles and fuel cell vehicles in France. So this is where fuel cell system comes. So what is a fuel cell? So here it is an individual cell. We have two electrodes separated by a membrane, and at the interface of the membrane and each of the electrodes, the anode and the cathode, we have a catalyst. So the catalyst is mainly composed of platinum. So we feed the anode side with hydrogen, and this hydrogen will flow until the catalyst, where we have this simple hydrogen oxidation. The electrons will flow through an external circuit, while the proton will flow through the membrane until reaching the other side, which is the cathode, where we are feeding the oxygen. So when the oxygen reaches this zone, we have the oxygen reduction equation. So this reaction gives us byproduct only water. So this is the global reaction. Hydrogen, oxygen gives water, electricity, and some heat, as the reaction are exothermics. So this is one cell of fuel cell. Okay, one individual fuel cell produces relatively small electrical potential. So the idea is to stack several individual cells like this into what we call a stack of fuel cell. Okay? So they are connected in series so that we get more voltage. And this is already one big advantage of fuel cell stack. It is the modularity. So that means I can build the stack in function of my need of power. So this is it. An individual fuel cell module fabrication, I have a stack. So this stack cannot operate alone. It needs several components so that it could operate. Of course, component to acheminate gases, to evacuate what produce water, to evacuate heat. So all these components that allow a good operation of my stack are called BOP, balance of plant. So this is why when I'm talking about fuel cell system, that means the stack and all the BOP components around. So just a few words about the application. They are very wide, going from transportation to stationary. Here, transportation, you can imagine all the application of transportation. Today, I'm glad to talk about some commercialization, which was not the case before 2015. So the first commercial car is released by Toyota in 2015. This is the Toyota Mirai. And this year, Honda also released one commercial fuel cell car, which is the Clarity SC. Daimler in Germany is announcing a new car in the coming months. So this is for the transportation application. Fuel cells are now commercialized. For the stationary, so we are talking more about producing combined heat and electricity. It could be also regeneration with cold as well. And here for the micro CHP, we already have some commercialization. In Europe, around 2014-2015, boosted by some huge demonstration project like Calux in Germany and the NFIT at the European level. In Japan, actually the commercialization started way before. It started in mid-2009. And the objective that has been reached is 150 kilo system, 1,000 system installed by end of 2008. So here you can see some images. If I go just to the Panasonic units of combined heat and power, so we have some numbers like reaching 45% of the electrical efficiency, and if we take the global efficiency, which includes also the heat efficiency, we can reach up to 94% efficiency with some lifetime above 10 years, which is really good systems. So the question is, why the commercialization of such promising system is slow? And here I go back to the fuel cell system, and if we see all the phenomena that happened inside the system. So we have different phenomena like thermal phenomena, mechanical one, fluidic one. So it's a multi-physics system and this phenomena acts at different dynamics. So the time constants are completely different. So we are talking about a multi-scale system. And of course, all the parameters that are involved are completely connected, so which make it a very complex system. So that means we need a very precise model to understand, to simulate the work, the optimization, the work, the diagnosis and the control of this system. And we need, before that, we need to master all the mechanisms that are behind the operation and the degradation. And this is not done yet. So here, just a small example of how a small fault in the system level could influence my fuel cell. For example, if I have a problem on the supply chain of hydrogen, that means there will not be enough hydrogen into my fuel cell, which means that I will have such a phenomena, which is the oxidation of the platinum, the catalyst platinum, which will release some surface like this. So the small particle will become bigger particle. That means the surface area will be lower, which will lower the performance. So this is just an example, and there is of course a lot of faults like this in the system. So if I have to classify the performance decay in a fuel cell system, I have two main types. The one is reversible, that means if I know the kind of fault and I inverse the cause of the fault, I can recover my performance. And the one that are non-reversible, and this is, for example, one example of that. Okay. So here I can see the evolution with time. So this is a kind of irreversible fault. That means even if I'm working in perfect condition, there will be always a performance decay due to aging. And here I can see some incident. That means if I resolve the problem with the incident, I will see some recovery. And usually the global performance is just the superposition of both. Just some small objectives here and about the fuel cells. So there is still a problem before commercialization of these three big issues, which are performance, cost, and durability. For the performance, today we have some performance that goes up to 30%, and the objective is 50%. So these numbers come from the DOE, Department of Energy, American Department of Energy, and they are aligned with the European objectives as well. For the cost, today we are at $1,000 for the units, and the objective is 40 euro per kilowatt. Okay, so we are way beyond these objectives. But here, just something to mention is that the cost is linked to the mass production. Of course, today we don't have this mass production, so the cost will be lower if we have a higher volume of production. For the durability, today we are at 4,000 hours of operation, and the objective is 5,000 hours. So this number is not really random. This is based on the classic combustion engine that we have. So if you want the fuel cell to be competitive, they have at least to reach the same number. So, and we are not that far away from this part. So the scientific question that arises, okay, how can I increase the performance, the lifetime, while I maintain or even decrease the cost? So how can I reduce or optimize the maintenance action? So all these questions have to be resolved before promoting the fuel cell systems. So this is the solution we are developing in our lab, so that calls PHM, Prognostics and Health Management. That means that we are going to manage the health of the fuel cell system and respond to it before having major failures. So there is different steps going from data acquisition, so this is the first step, and here we have different approaches. All these approaches are developed in our lab. So this is electrochemical approaches. I'm not going into this. I'm just explaining the whole picture. So when we have the data, when we collected the data, so we have different way of analyzing them, going from data mining, signal processing. After that, we have condition assessment and diagnosis, which means if I have a fault, I have to know first if there is a fault or not. And if there is a fault, I have to know which kind of fault, what are the causes. So this is different approaches going from neural network, Bayesian neural networks, and so on. I need to know at each time how many lifetime is remaining for my system. So this is prognostics. The idea is to predict the future behavior of my fuel cell and of course the remaining useful lifetime. And in function of that, take a decision okay, if I have a fault or if I have just 100 hours left, what can I do to change that? So this is the whole approach, and this work is more focused on this part. So these are the approaches, the steps I already told you. So monitoring, diagnostics and prognostics, and then taking decision after that. The decision could be either changing the operating conditions so that I continue to work safely, or stop the system and call for maintenance. So we have two types of decisions. Post-prognostics decisions, so how can I adapt my control to avoid excessive aging? So this is what we call DTC, and that was presented yesterday in the poster number one. And the second one is post-diagnostics decisions, so how can I adapt my control to avoid fault or failures? And this is called FTC, fault-tolerant control, and that was the second poster. And of course, this work is about the fault-tolerant control. So here, the objective is that the system is able to detect itself when a fault occurs and to adapt its operation to counteract this fault. So this is a three-step architecture. So first step is a model of diagnostics to determine the state of health, but not only determine this state of health, but also determine the faults, their amplitude, and their severity. The second step is the decision making. So all this information we take from here are used to define all the action that will counteract this problem, and this action, of course, at the control level, at the first stage, and then at the maintenance. And the last step is really operate this control according to these actions. One very important step for that is the fault structural analysis. So sometimes when I'm acting on a fault, maybe I can trigger other faults. So the idea is to make sure that when I'm acting on a fault, I'm not making the situation worse. So here, from a structural analysis angle, the fuel cell system has bonds when we are in the operating condition which is normal. There are bonds. When a fault occurs, these bonds are changed. They are invalidated. So here, we are just making a list of all faults and all the bonds that are changed. Okay, and we are making some diagram like this. Each parameter will have some constraints that are influenced by a fault. Okay, and the idea is that we will emphasize the control variable that allows fault mitigations without provoking others, because we know it from this diagram, and reset all the fuel cell constraints. So this study has been done before for all different types of faults. And after that, we can implement the decision model that takes the available information on the system, here state of health and remaining usable lifetime, and feed the control with all the appropriate actions. So the objective is safe operation, high system reliability, that means my system is able to respond to what I want it to do, availability to avoid stopping the system because of failure, and to extend the lifetime by avoiding some irreversible faults. The decision we implement in this work are two levels. So the first level is the fast decision. Fast decision means I have a fault, and I know this fault is very critical, so I will do a change in my control very fastly. I will act very fastly, as quickly as possible. Long-term decision means I have a fault, but it is not that critical. So I can afford using other actions which are more long-term, but that will allow me to preserve my fuel cell. And sometimes, and often, we are using both. So in this work, we decided to use fast decision unless we have a fault that appears twice. So this is the results here. I'm going to present only for one fault, but you can see here the output of our diagnostic model. So this is the probability of different faults. We've done this work for 7 different faults. And this is the probability of occurrence, for example, for flooding. Flooding is when my system is not able anymore to evacuate liquid water. So the water is stuck into the fuel cell. So here, this is the probability evolution. Here, this is just an evolution between 0, non-fault, 1 fault. And here, this is the actions we are doing so that we can avoid the falls. So here the action is more operating in the flow rate of air. If we have some water stacked in the fuel cell, we will send more air so that the air will flush the water. So here, up to now, we have validated this on a single fuel cell, and there are some experiments ongoing on stack to see if we still have the same results on stack. So that brings me to the conclusions. So here, I just give a summary about this work. So this AFTC, active photon architecture, involves the combination of three different modules: diagnostics, decision, and control. So the idea is that before going to decisions, we will run a fault structural analysis that will allow us to know what are the best parameters to act on in order to mitigate our fault. So the decision architecture is modular, which means that we have block by block implementation. And this is very great if we want the method to be generic. That means we don't want it to be used on only one fuel cell, but maybe applied to other fuel cells. And this is actually what gives us the possibility of extending this. So this is some perspectives where we can run several modules in parallel and then see which one gives the best results. That will improve the robustness of our approach. Now we are running in the lab experiments on single cell. I think they are finishing next week, and we are starting right after that the short step. We will start with the five single cells from the beginning. And yeah, this is the combination that we are going to validate with the data coming from this experiment and campaign. So this is it. I just want to emphasize that this project has been supported by the region, Bourgogne-Franche-Comté, where I come from, by the region, Réunion, which the PhD students come from, and the LabEx Action Programme, where I am holding a share of excellence for the next 3 years. So this is the generated publications from this work. And just one small announcement, we are organizing a conference next December about all the electrical vehicles, including fuel cell vehicles. So if you are interested, you can have more information about this conference on this website. Thank you very much for your attention.